All right. Okay. Turn to 2 Corinthians. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Sorry. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And everybody's been talking about Happy New Year, and I figured, well, you know, maybe we should talk about happiness, because I talk to a lot of people in my ministry where people aren't very happy. So it's like, well, so what? Okay, your happiness is really not the most important thing in your life. The reason for that is God didn't call you to be happy. He called you to be faithful, and he called you to have joy in your life. And as I said last week, joy is better than happiness because it is superior in this sense that it transcends circumstances. Okay, so when you get into this type of thinking where the circumstances all have to be together, you know, you say, well, everything's just right. Everything's just perfect, you know. I mean, this is like you got your ducks in a row. Or if you've ever seen ducks in a row, you know that that's almost an impossibility, okay? It's like herding cats, okay? It doesn't work. So if your life's going to be constantly trying to juggle all the problems and all the things that are going on, and you're trying to get everything perfect, and you're trying to get all this stuff together, that's going to be, for you, elusive. It's going to be very rare. It's going to fleet and go away. It's going to be frustrating, and it's not how you have joy in your life. Joy comes from peace. It comes from understanding grace. It comes from understanding what real love is. It comes from faith. It comes from understanding God's word. It comes from holiness. That's understanding that he's holy, and that you can now, in the body of Christ, also walk in holiness, okay? That makes people happy, because unholy people that know they're unholy when they're lost get saved, and they wrestle with, how can I be holy? I say, well, why would God ask you to do something that you can't do? He tells you to be holy. So what does that mean? It means to be set apart. So if you're not going to be sanctified and holy, then what are you going to be? We had a conversation in there today with the girls about modest apparel. And that went into another conversation about the difference between cotton and polyester. I have no idea where that went, but I was trying to explain to them the difference between cotton comes from cotton and linen comes from flax. And the reason you want these things to work properly in your garments is that they soak up the sweat. And then when the sweat evaporates, it cools you off. That's why you do it. And so when you use some of these synthetic fibers, I'm going, what has all this got to do with modesty? Well, it has to do with what you look like on the street, okay? If you look like a streetwalker, somebody might, they might just confuse you with a streetwalker, okay? So as you're training your little girls to grow up, what do you want them to look like? And I asked them today, who do you not want to look like? And they said, Miley Cyrus. I said, good one, all right. So you know that they're thinking about this. And they want to know what modest apparel is. They want to know what it means to look like a woman of God as opposed to a woman of the night. And so as they get a little older, they can start, you know, kind of reading some of these other passages that teach them more about that. The idea of all of this trying to come together in your life to make a perfect life so that you feel happy all the time, anything that involves feelings is going to be a problem. Okay, so in the midst of your depression and frustration and headaches and hassles and all the things that go on inside your day, stop and think about how you jump out of that. Where's the easy button for that? Where is the ripcord? What is it, the escape hatch that you have during the day? Turn to Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. And get Romans chapter 12, 1 Corinthians 4, verse 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. Paul says this, "For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hast not received it?" So if a person is completely enamored with their own looks, you have to ask them, where did that come from? Did you create the way you look? Well, no, my mom looks like this, or my aunt looks like this. My family, my genetics, right. So it wasn't you that did it, you see. If you have talent, where does that come from? It's developed, right? You develop talent. But doesn't it take somebody else developing it in you in order for that to work. It's not just you developing it yourself. It's the developing of you with someone else. That's called teaching, and we know that. So what he's talking about here is this. Paul's talking about Apollos and himself and saying, you guys are lifting us both up on a pedestal, and you're worshiping both of us instead of the Lord. And when you do that, you're creating division in the assemblies. And so we don't want you to do that. And he says, Apollos and I both agree on this, okay? That we don't want you to do this. Look at verse 6. And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself and to Apollos for your sakes, that ye might learn in us not to think of men above that which is written, that no one of you be puffed up for one against another. One of the questions in the Psychobabble handout, it's not in yours, but I'll read it to you. I've got it in mine. I thought this was pretty funny. I was looking through, it says, how narcissists wear out their welcome. That's a good one. And the other one was, I think about, there was another one about narcissists. I don't know if I have it on here or not. Why narcissists think they're better than you. Why do they think they're better than you? Is it overconfidence? Have you been watching Donald Trump lately? I mean, have you seen this guy? I mean, it's funny. It's a circus. There's no doubt about it. But you know, he is very confident. But the phenomenon is not that he's this way. Anybody that's ever watched him or seen his show or watched him in the news and watched his whole career knows this is him. He's being himself. But what's happening, the phenomenon is that everybody's following it. They love it. They think this is great. Because they want something better. They're afraid. People are fearful right now. And they're looking for somebody who's going to come in and fix it. You remember H. Ross Perot when he ran for president? He kept saying, we'll fix it. We'll fix it. I'm going to fix it. Jeb Bush tried a little campaign here for about 3 days about him fixing it. And wow, that went over like that. You don't say you're going to fix anything. See the thinking here about putting men up on a pedestal? That's been going on too long in politics and religion, everywhere. So as you begin to think about happiness and you begin to think about these things, Paul says, this is really good. He says, for what maketh thee to differ from another? I mean, that's a really, really good point. Okay, he says that if you measure yourselves among yourselves, you're not wise. Can you not always compare yourself with other people in many occasions and find something about you that's superior to the other person? You know? I mean, I'm taller than you. Whoop-dee-doo. I mean, what difference does that make? Okay? That's not your decision. That wasn't your decision. So that was in your DNA. It has nothing to do with that. So what makes you so special for being that way? People try to get this worked out in their heads that if they get everything together, they're going to be happy. And I can tell you that people, that you were talking about the lotto this morning, it's up to 1.2, 1.3 billion with the Powerball thing and everybody, you know, this whole thing about people that get rich, they get lots of money, and you know why they're so miserable and why they're so unhappy? It's because they've been operating under the delusion for most of their life that money would give them all the things that they need to solve their problems in life. And when they get it, and it doesn't, but it brings more trouble, okay, then they don't know what to do. Read the book of Ecclesiastes. Read the book that Solomon wrote about the preacher, okay? And read what he says. And as you read through his books, as you go back there and read what Solomon says, he says, basically, I had it all. I had it all. I did it all. I wanted it all. I took it all. I did all the things I wasn't supposed to do. And when he got done with his ministry as a king for 40 years over Israel, wow, he made a mess of things, big time mess. And as a result, he writes about it. Read the first chapter of Proverbs. Read the second chapter of Proverbs. Keep reading, and you'll see a man trying to teach his grown children how to recognize a streetwalker. How? Not to get involved with them, okay? He's trying to save his children from the inevitable. And yet at the same time, he had experience, and I think he was quite able to teach them that. It was a sad thing. Any man who has 700 wives and 300 concubines, somebody asked me what the 300 concubines were. I said, that's a harem is what that is, okay? That's not what God wanted the kings of Israel to do. He says, you do not multiply wives unto yourself. And so when a guy says, happy wife, happy life, what do you do when you got 1,000 of them? Now, that wasn't at one time. He had them over a period of time. But when you have that many women in your life, how do you keep them all happy? You can't. It's impossible. Why would you even try? But the idea is, in most households today, that if mama's happy, everybody's happy. Well, that's true most of the time. But the problem is if mom's trying to get happy and be happy the wrong way, she's going to continue to fail. And as she continues to fail, she's going to get frustrated, and then she's going to seek happiness elsewhere. That's a problem. So what you want to do is teach your wife and teach your husband together what God's word says about happiness. And what you have in Christ is more than enough to make you happy. Okay, last week we talked about the verse in Acts chapter 20. Turn over to Romans chapter 12. I wanted to remind you of that, but we'll go ahead to Romans 12 first. Romans chapter 12, the foundational passage on how to get out of the problems that are in your head. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. Now, what's a living sacrifice as opposed to what? What's a dead sacrifice? That's a sacrifice you would offer over there on the altar in the old program. That's a sacrificial animal. That's a dead sacrifice. You kill it and you burn it. What's a living sacrifice? That's a living, walking, breathing testimony. That's you being a sacrificial testimony. That means that you go through the process of living how? What is the living sacrifice identified as? The first word after sacrifice is what? Holy. So if you can't be holy, why would God say you can be holy? Look over to Titus chapter 3. You can be holy. Is there sacrifice involved with that? Yeah, people will say, you're holier than thou. You ever had people tell you that? You're holier than thou. Why are you being holier than thou? What do you mean you don't want to drink? Well, what do you mean you don't, you know, whatever. I mean, people give you a hard time. Well, so what? He says in verse 12, teaching us. Well, what teaches you? Look down in verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. What does that teach us? Not just that we're saved. It teaches us that denying ungodliness, that's holiness. And worldly lust, that's holiness. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. You notice he says in verse 14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. Now, listen, this is not after you're dead. This is while you're still living the life in Christ that you're living right now. These are not things that are going to happen in heaven. Okay, turn over to Galatians chapter 5. If you want to demonstrate to somebody that you're going to be sinless in heaven, here's the verse. You know you're going to be sinless in heaven. Right? Right. Well, how do you know? This verse. He says in verse 5, for we through the Spirit wait for the hope of what? Righteousness. So by faith, you believe what the Holy Spirit writes to you, that you're righteous. Now, if the Holy Spirit says you're righteous, what does he mean?
Well, he means that you had it imputed to you. So you have righteousness right now.
Okay, turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and look at this passage. He says, 2 Corinthians 5, you know this passage, you know exactly where I'm going. 2 Corinthians 5, 21. Right? For he hath made him to be sin for us. Now, was he qualified to do that? Well, look at after the comma after us. He's talking about Jesus Christ, who knew no sin. That's why he's qualified. Then he says that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now, when does righteousness come? When does it happen in your life? Well, if you get made righteous by the Lord Jesus Christ, and you trust Christ, and you're made righteous in Christ, it happens instantaneously. We call that being justified. The righteousness of God is given to you as a gift. It's imputed to your account, and now you have eternal life. You already have it. You possess righteousness. Before the justice bar of God, you are completely righteous. But are you completely righteous in your daily life every day? Well, let's just say you're righteous 90% of the time, okay? Well, that'd be great. If you could be righteous acting 90% of your day, would that be good? That'd be a pretty good living sacrifice, okay? If 9 out of 10 minutes of your day, every day, you were being exactly like you should be in Christ all the time, 9 times out of 10, people would go, wow. What is that? Now, I'm not talking about acting holy now. I'm not talking about putting on some sort of kind of false thing. I'm talking about you realizing that you're not always acting righteous in the things that you do, in your words, in your thoughts, and in your deeds, but that someday you will. And Galatians 5 says that you now wait for that hope of righteousness. Meaning that hope, it doesn't mean that you might get it and you might not. It's the hope that is that confident expectation of a sure thing that it's going to happen on the day he says it's going to happen. Turn over to Ephesians chapter 1, and he makes it clear that the Holy Spirit living in you is living proof that you're going to get the rest of it. What's the rest of it? The rest of it is your new body. So what happens when you shed this shell? You go to be with the Lord, okay? And then eventually at the rapture, when that occurs, we're all going to get our new bodies at the same time. If you look at Ephesians 1, and he says in verse 13, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the Holy Spirit. He is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, and that will all be done unto the praise of his glory. It's fantastic. It's the day. It's that day. You hear it called that day. Paul talks about that. I just gave that verse to Jan. 2 Timothy chapter 4. Look at verse 7. Paul says, 4:7, 2 Timothy 4:7. I have fought a good fight, he says. Now, he's not saying I've been a good fighter. He's not saying that. I mean, he was a good fighter. I mean, he's a classic model for the body of Christ. He's the pattern, Paul, our pattern. But what is he saying there? He says, I fought a good fight. Now, what he's really saying is all these other fights you guys are fighting are not good fights. They're terrible fights. They're your fights. You want to leave a legacy. You're fighting up, get up the ladder. See? You're wanting to make a bunch of money so you can have a lot of power over people. Oh, that's your fight, okay? You're going out there and you're trying to show how many women that you think you're just the most special thing in the world and that you know everything there is to know about everything, and they're calling you a narcissist. But they still take your money, okay? So all of these things that men go out and women go out and pursue, whether it be legacy and a heritage, want their name on a statue, or they want to win the Nobel Prize, or whatever it is. Forget it, okay? He says, that's not the fight. The fight that he's talking about, I have fought a good fight, is the fight that God calls us to fight. And he says, I have finished my course. None of those things I just mentioned are in your course of service. He says, I have what? He says, I have finished my course. Paul is the only other man in the New Testament, other than the Lord Jesus Christ, that ever said he finished what God gave him to do. And he did that. Now, he says here, he says, I have kept the faith. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, from now on, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Now, what's the crown of righteousness for? Well, it's a moniker. It's a demonstration of who you are. If a bunch of people walk in and the guy's got a crown on, who you think's the king? It's the guy that's got the crown on. It's a moniker. It's a symbol, a sign. It's a special headpiece that says, I'm king and you're not. Okay, that's all it is. And the woman wears one too, and she's the queen. Okay, and then the prince wears one, and the princess wears one. And you go to Disney World, and all the little kids are wearing them. I mean, even the little boys are wearing these things, you know. No. So, you know, there's laid up, he says. When something's laid up, what does that mean? It's set aside. It's in store. It's waiting for you. Your crown is waiting for you. I like that whole concept where the 24 elders in the book of Revelation take their crowns and they cast them at the Lord and all that. And people, they think they're going to do that. Maybe we will. Okay, I don't know. But I do know this, that the crown of righteousness will be a moniker for me in eternity that I was made righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ, and he will personally give me that moniker. Now, you think that's going to be wonderful to get that? You think that's going to be exciting? Look at what Paul says. He says, I have fought a good fight. I have kept I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at what? That day. That's the day you get your new body. That's the day you get your crown of righteousness. That's the day that you're looking for. That's the day that you're going to have a complete and total memory that does not involve sin. It does not involve wickedness. You will not be able to think a wicked thought. You will not be able to think a bad thought. You will not be able to plot or plan or lie or any of those things. You will not be able to do it. It will be gone from you. Somebody was telling me, they were discussing this issue about a lost person, and they were asking me, are we going to know all the lost people that we don't have in heaven with us when we get there? And I said, well, I really can't answer that question scripturally, but I will say this. It wouldn't be what I consider to be heaven if I was spending it worrying about all the people that I knew that are now in the lake of fire, because that's going to be more people than I could possibly ever want to remember, okay? Because you meet more lost people in your life than you do that you see get saved, right? It's a very small percentage of people get saved. So are we going to worry about that? No, you're not going to worry about it. You're going to have a new mindset about that. I had a person whose father died lost, and he knew he was unsaved, and he was in a quandary because he didn't know how to talk about it with other people when he was given his testimony. He didn't want to say that his dad was lost. And, you know, he didn't want to do that because there's other members of the family and all that were really, yeah, we don't talk about dad like that. Dad's in heaven. Everything's cool. No, he's not. He's not in heaven. And this guy is saying that because he was working with him and dealing with his soul. And he knew he wasn't saved, and his dad professed he wasn't saved. And so he says, you know, I don't know how to deal with this personally. I said, well, do you think that people that reject the gospel of Christ should go to hell? He says, yes, I do. I said, okay, so what's the difference? If you think everybody, you know, should go to hell, why should you think your dad should not go to hell? He says, well, I it's not that I don't think he shouldn't go to hell. He says, I don't want him to. I said, okay, so now you're getting there, okay? Guess what? If he denies the Lord Jesus Christ and denies the Word of God, he's going to get what he gets, okay? And you're tied to him through the blood and through your genetic system. You came from him. I said, that's not nearly as strong as the tie you now have to the Lord Jesus Christ because of what he gave to you. That's the lifeline, not what you've got with daddy, okay? Listen, some people grow up and never even have a daddy, okay? They don't even know him. They had one, but they don't know who he is. Listen, you have one. And it's not your earthly father, okay? It's not your earthly mother. It's not any of those things. Those things are absolutely and clearly taught easily in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The guy says, I'll follow you, but I got to go bury my dad. He goes, no, let the dead bury the dead. Let them go. The dead is dead. They're dead in trespasses and sins. Let them go take care of that. If you either believe me and follow me or you don't, okay? That's all there is to it. So when you start looking at this, you say, you know, you don't wish anybody harm or you don't wish or you're not happy that they're in hell. The question is, do you know where you're going and do you know what that's going to be for you? And yes. So the question isn't not what your father believed or your mother believed or your brothers and sisters believed or your husband believed or your wife believed. The question is, what are you going to do with this? Are you going to believe it or are you going to sit here and whine about this and that? The idea for happiness is, if you begin to understand the joy of being in Jesus Christ and the joy that that brings, turn back to Romans 12. If you understand the key of how to blink yourself out, haven't you ever thought how cool it would be to just be able to twitch your nose like Samantha on Bewitched and just make everything happen the way you want to? Didn't she get in more trouble than she made? Didn't she was always getting in trouble, wasn't she? You know? So if you think that's the way life should be for you, think again. Because when you make big, bad decisions, you can learn great things from that. And you can put it to your own advantage, and you can turn it around, and you can do those things because you can learn from your own mistakes. Romans 5. But notice what he says. Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 1. So you present your bodies a living sacrifice and holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world. Getting long, scraggly hair with earrings and stuff like that, and thinking you're cool and all that stuff. And, you know, I spent the first year of my life playing baseball as a child. I spent wanting to look like a baseball player more than playing a baseball game. You know why? Because I wasn't any good, okay? I was just a little guy, peewee ball. I was in peewee ball. And my dad was actually coaching the team. And I said, why do you keep putting me on the bench so much? Why don't you let me play? He goes, because you don't know what you're doing. I said, okay, so tell me what to do. So he says, get out there and I'll show you what to do. And we started working and doing the fundamentals. And before long, I'm starting to ground the ball and I'm starting to throw the ball and I'm starting to catch the ball and I'm starting to have fun. It is amazing what will happen if you just practice a little bit, you know? And I began to learn about baseball, and I began to watch baseball. I watched some of the greatest baseball games in the history of baseball. I watched the Mets play the Cardinals. I watched all that going on. And when I was young, I enjoyed baseball. But as I grew up in baseball and I learned how to play baseball, I found myself pitching, playing all positions. I caught. That was my favorite position. I learned to play baseball. It was great. It was fun. It was exciting. But for a while in the beginning, I just wanted to look like a baseball player. I just wanted the uniform. And this is very common with people. They don't want to actually do anything of any real substance. They just want to look like it. And you go, you know, that's sad, you know? And so today when you see the little guys emulating the pro athletes, it's not they want to just be the players like that. They want the cars and the money and all the stuff that goes with it. So the ancillary sideline stuff that comes from being a superstar, megastar, that's what they want to be. That's why they get into it. You know, the role models of those guys, it's pathetic, okay? And it's very, very bad to see kids emulate those guys. And what happens is you find them being conformed. He says, and be not conformed. Don't be drawn into that conformity. Don't be a conformist, okay? Now, they say, well, I'm going to be a nonconformist. Well, I want to be different. Okay, if you're going to be a nonconformist, read the verse a little bit further. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. So where is the transformation going to take place? How do you hit the easy button on this and just go, boom, okay, make it go away? You use your free will that God gave you. You use volition. You take what's going on inside your head and you reevaluate it and you make decisions based upon what you now understand to be absolutely true from the Word of God. Larry Sanborn corrected me on this one time. We were talking about renewing your mind, and I said, yeah, that's a daily, hourly thing. He says, no, that's a minute-by-minute thing. I said, yes, sir, you're right. It is. Because in order to get through a decent hour of the day, you gotta be thinking about these things all the time, minute by minute by minute, not day by day. It's okay to live your life in minute increments, as long as you're not worrying through them all and worrying about this and worrying about that. You fix your mind on what God is doing and He will transform you. How many of you have ever laid in bed at night and started thinking about all the things that you didn't get done today or have to do tomorrow? And you can't sleep. You ever done that? It's bad. Okay, you start thinking about work and forget it, okay? You start thinking about all the stuff that you got to do. And it's like, oh my gosh, this is horrible. And oh, I can't. And before you know it, you look up at the clock and it's like, that was 45 minutes ago I laid down. And I'm still laying here. My doctor, she told me, this sleep doctor I use, she said, if you don't go to sleep in 20 minutes, get up. I said, okay. So if I don't go to sleep right away, if I lay down and I don't go to sleep, I get up. So my house is continually haunted all the time by me. So my wife could catch me out in my shop working in the middle of 3 a.m. She could catch me in the kitchen. She could catch me in my office because my day does not run 6 to 6 and then rest until midnight, go to sleep. It doesn't work like that. My life works in small increments of time, all the way around the clock, okay? And I do whatever I have to do. I do whatever I have to do to get 12 hours worth of work in every day. If I get 10, I'm okay, but I want 12. I want 6. I want a break. I want another 6, okay? And then I have time to spend with my wife and so forth. You know, the thing is, you can get a lot done if you plan your day right. But if you don't get any sleep, you won't get much done at all, okay? So you have to pace yourself. I don't live today like I did when I was 20 and 30. I can't do it. Old dogs lay on the porch. You know that. That's the way it is. That's just the way it is. But as you grow up, you begin to realize that it's the thinking, okay? And it's the transformation of your life through the transforming of the doctrine in your mind. Notice what he says, But be ye transformed by how? The renewing of your mind. Change your thinking. That ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So that is the key right there to having a life that is acceptable and perfect in the will of God. And it's a good thing. I mean, it's a great thing. So if you're going to think on these things. Look over Philippians. We're about done. This is about learning the difference between you trying to force the thing and just letting the doctrine work in you. Just let it work in you. Paul says in Philippians chapter 4, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, and believe me, there is, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, those things that happen deep, deep down inside of you, in your innermost feeling. Have you ever gotten scared and gotten butterflies in your stomach? Have you ever done that? Have you ever sat in the principal's office and got butterflies in your stomach? Or go to the doctor and you're getting ready to get a root canal and you go, I'd rather be anywhere than here, right? Yeah. And so that deep down emotional feeling that you get will actually transfer itself into physical feelings. That's what butterflies are. Stomach pains, feelings, okay? And you so, we way down, he says, and mercies, he says, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. No competition, none of that stuff that was going on at Corinth. He doesn't want you to do that. But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. There's the definition of love right there. That is real love. You know, real love is so wonderful that you don't even have to have somebody's permission to love them. Now, I'm not talking spooky, stalking kind of love. I'm not talking about that kind of stuff where you're looking in the window at night and all that kind of stuff. I'm talking about not love from afar. I'm talking about you determining in your mind that you love that person, and no matter what they say, do, whatever, there's not going to be anything that will stop you from loving that person. Now, there might be some things that that person does to you that makes you say, well, I can't be around you if you're going to do that. They keep smacking you in the face all the time. You know, how are you going to live with that? Okay, they keep tripping you every time you walk in the room. What are you going to do? Eventually, you're going to say, stop. Well, I'm not talking about people that abuse you. I'm talking about just the general idea of how you love others and that esteeming others better than yourselves. That's something that takes place with renewing of the mind. You quit loving you and start loving them. Look not every man on his own things, he says, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you. Which mind is that? That's the mind of Christ. He says, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And notice, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. Can you imagine the Creator humbling himself in the midst of the creatures around him? That's the weirdest thing. And he says, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. What's the result? What happened to him? He says, wherefore God also highly exalted him. And what? And given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Guess what? You see that you see that exalted position? You see that ascended, glorified, exalted position? That word exalted turns into this word when you understand it. When you understand something and it makes you happy beyond words, it goes from understanding his exaltation, which is where he was risen up to you understanding it. You know what the word that you would use? Glory to God. Hallelujah. You see those words in the Bible? Those are words of exaltation. That's when you start to get it. Do you realize that you're in Christ now? And that everything he has and is now part of you, and you're sitting here going, well, I hope so. You better do more than that, because the more you realize it, the happier you're going to be. But it's going to transcend right through happiness into joy. Joy unspeakable and full of glory, Paul says. All joy and peace in believing this. We don't always have the opportunity to try to share this kind of thing with people, because people are so bent on happiness coming from money and other things that they just cannot understand why you're so happy. Are you happy? You sing that song at camp? I'm so happy, so very happy. Your dad used to make a fool of himself singing that. He'd run around the whole thing. Remember seeing that? He would do that, and it was so funny. And everybody, that really became kind of the funny part of that song that we used to sing, was watching him do that. But, you know, it is true that even people that are basically depressed in life, or people that have trouble in life, and people that have, they're down, and people that have trouble and problems, they can transcend all of that and have joy and have it unspeakable by understanding what you already know. Paul says, now is our salvation nearer than when we first believed. That part of us that's going to go up there and rule and reign in the heavenlies, well, it's getting closer as the days click on. This is our 28th year at the conference this year. Can you believe that? I remember the very first one. And I had a great experience at the very first one. Oscar actually started the very first one by himself. And he had Brother Rick come to a hotel in downtown Orlando. And I went over there, and I went over there by myself. And I went over there, and it was after that conference that Oscar called me, and because we were having a conference over here for the church, and Richard was coming to that, and then he had him over there. He says, why don't we just combine these together? We'll make one conference. And I said, yeah, sounds good to me. And I was there after the meetings. I went up to the hotel room, and I was dead tired, man. And I flicked on the news, and I got cleaned up. I'm going to go to sleep. I'm going to try to get some sleep tonight so I can get up early and hear these guys preaching. Because Richard had about 25 or 30 Baptist preachers at this meeting. Oscar had personally invited all these guys that were Baptist preachers to listen to the message of the Word Rightly Divided. And so the first evening, it was fantastic. And I said, I'm going to go get some rest. I'd driven all the way over there. I worked, you know, in the morning, and I got over there. And it was just the evening meeting, and then the next day we're going to go at it again. And these guys are all going to sit there, and there's a big old chalkboard, and he had all the tables set up. And boy, it was so good to see the back of the heads of all these Baptist preachers, because boy, they were getting earfuls of this stuff. And I didn't know it at the time, but I'm laying there in the bed, and I'd fallen asleep, and then I start dreaming about Richard preaching to these Baptist preachers. Because that's what I had been doing that day. You know how you dream about something that's going on in your life? Well, I wake up, and he's on the TV preaching. The message that I had been watching him do that night was already videotaped and was being sent to the rooms of everybody at the conference. And so the news had gone off, and then this thing had come on the same channel. I didn't turn it on there. It just kind of popped on, I guess. I don't know what it was. They just run it in there. I woke up in the middle of the night, and I'm looking at that, and I'm going, I thought it was in my room. I didn't know what was going on. I woke up, and I'm going, what in the world is that? I didn't even know they could do that. I had no idea. That was the freakiest thing. I was so excited about that meeting that I thought, well, I'm just dreaming about it. No, it was because he was actually in the room talking on the television. You know, you realize that sometimes you get a little hopped up about these things, and you get excited about them. And you get with other people, and they don't seem to share your enthusiasm so much, you know. I said, well, that's okay. The angels do. I don't care whether you do or not. I'm just, I'm doing what I'm told to do. What are you doing? That's what I want to know. So when we all get to glory, it's all going to come out the way it should. He's going to give us the crown of righteousness, and we're going to be put into service out there in those heavenly places. That'll be the true Star Wars, only we won't have to fight ugly animals and creepy people. We're going to be dealing with, you know, basically watching some of the things take place that go on as the transition into the prophetic program takes place. So it's going to be fun, and I'm looking forward to it. I hope you are too. Let's have a word of prayer, and we'll stop. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word today. We thank you for the joy that we have in Christ. We thank you, Lord, that while happiness does tend to come and go, we know that joy is possible all the time. And we thank you for it. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.